Praise be Jesus Christ in his most precious blood. This is Matthew Tibbetan from Reformed and Catholic, and today I'm going to be reading a paper called Sacraments According to Pseudo-Dionysius and Jonathan Edwards. This paper was written my sophomore year of college, and originally it started off as a research paper that I wanted to do comparing Christian mysticism and Reformed theology, although as the research progressed, I had to narrow it down into two theologians and a particular question. Thus, the topic of my research became sacraments according to Pseudo-Dionysius and Jonathan Edwards. So without further ado, I'll just begin reading. Abstract. This essay seeks to compare the sacramental views of the 5th to 6th century theologian Pseudo-Dionysius the Areopagite with those of the Puritan theologian and pastor Jonathan Edwards. While these two men appear to have little in common, they both share a Neoplatonic framework and express similar emphases in their theology of the sacraments. While they may both emphasize union with God and the Church, ontological transformation of the sacrament, unveiling of Christ, and real presence, they depart with regard to the presence of apophaticism in the sacraments. While Dionysius maintains a robust overarching apophaticism that constitutes the elements and pedagogical nature of the supper, Edwards' approach lacks apophatic nuances in his understanding of the liturgy, maintaining heavier emphasis on the reality of Christ's true presence and the reenactment of Christ's original work. Why make the comparison? The Reformed tradition has historically been understood as opposed to Christian mysticism and its Catholic counterparts during the Reformation. Bernard McGinn describes that for many Protestants outside the academy, the aversion to mysticism comes from a flawed view that mysticism mingles the line between the divine and human when discussing what communication, participation, and sharing in the divine nature entails. Historically, the opposition between mysticism and the Reformed tradition is evidently observed in how Calvin and Luther departed on the work of Theologia Deutsch. Luther described that he owed more to the Theologia Deutsch more than any other book, next to the Bible and the writings of St. Augustine. In a letter to Frankfurt, dated February 23, 1559, Calvin disparages the book, describing it, quote, "in the name of God, to flee like the plague all those who try to infect it with such trash," end quote. In another letter to the congregations in Frankfurt, Calvin urges the same German reform to do nothing with the book, quote, "for although there are no outstanding errors in it, it contains frivolities covered by Satan's cunning in order to confuse the whole simplicity of the gospel. And if you look deeper into it, you will find that it contains a hidden deadly poison which can poison the church. Therefore, my brethren, shun like the pest all those who try to defile you with such impurities," end quote. Guillaume Farel in Basel believed that the work originated with the arch-heretic David Joris, a worse pejorative in Farel's vocabulary. Theodore Beza similarly looked very dimly at the publication of a Theologia Deutsch in Swiss territory. Concerning Pseudo-Dionysius in particular, Hermann Bavinck articulates a rising critique, quote, "when it, the believer, frees itself from all earthly ties, suppresses all its conceptual images, kills consciousness and will, and turns inward to its own deepest being, it finds God himself there and enters into full communion with him. On this sublime level, there is no longer any barrier between God and the soul. The soul has become pure luminosity, spiritualized and divinized. All distinction and separation is God. God and the soul are one," end quote. Despite the perceived incompatibility between the Reformed and mystical traditions, on a superficial level, there is a high degree of continuity between the two. At the outset of this research, I described how a systematized Calvinistic ethos of desiring solely God, cultivating an awareness of God's presence, and the radical pursuit of God's glory are areas of affinity that the mystic and Reformed tradition share more than other Christian traditions. Further into this research, the areas of mystical union and apophatic theology were also identified as extreme points of similarity. Significant Reformed theologians such as John Calvin, Hermann Bavinck, and John Murray held union of Christ to be a preeminent doctrine. Furthermore, the Reformed inherited a form of apophaticism, primarily in the doctrine of incomprehensibility and use of a modified divine simplicity as inherited from scholastic thought. Grounds for comparison: the theologian's Neoplatonism. Dionysius and Edwards' shared usage of Neoplatonism is a cause for very similar theological conclusions. Edwards' theology of divinization, divine light, and parallels to Palamism have raised attention to whether he read the Patristics or later Orthodox as an influence to his Neoplatonic teaching. While there is no sufficient reason to believe he read the above, many have suggested his influence to be from the 17th century Cambridge Platonists. These Cambridge Platonists shared the language of deification, participation, and emanation, which distinguished Edwards from most of his contemporaries in the broader Reformed tradition. For example, while much of the Reformed preferred discussing righteousness and justification as forensic and imputive, Edwards and the Cambridge Platonists would not err from describing the Christian life as affecting our nature and ontological. Moreover, Edwards and the Cambridge Platonists would be comfortable with describing the Christian life and change within the believer to be a product of their participation within the life of God. John Smith describes the above ideas in his definition of divinization in The Excellency and Nobles of True Religion. Quote, God is a first truth and primitive goodness. True religion is vigorous efflux and emanation of both upon the spirits of men, and therefore is called a participation of the divine nature. End quote. Moreover, the opposition from contemporaries these Neoplatonists found is witnessed in how Benjamin Wycote, the founder of the Cambridge Platonists, sought to defend deification, appealing to 2 Peter 1 verse 4. Finally, Edwards' reading, Catalog of Books, cites John Smith's Select Discourses and Ralph Cudworth's True Intellectual System of the Universe. Edwards' ideas of God's self-communication of himself through creaturely participation by the Spirit in Edwards' End of Creation is anticipated in Smith's Select Discourses. Pseudo-Dionysius is well established to be embedded in Neoplatonic philosophy. Regarding Dionysian Platonism, leading Neoplatonic scholars, including Stephen Gersh and Ronald F. Hathaway, are certain of a Christian faith is expressed by Dionysius, as well as convinced of his attendance at the Academy of Athens. Furthermore, it appears likely that Dionysius would have sat under Proclus, circa 410-485, who was a scholar or a director of the Academy in 476. Apart from Proclus, the scholar Iambicus, circa 245-325, and his teaching on theurgy, or divine work, have also been a new point of current interest related to Dionysius' usage of, quote, things of the Greek, end quote, to describe the effect of the sacraments. Finally, Dionysius' apophatic or negative theology develops out of a Neoplatonic conclusion developed and matured by Damasius, the scholar from 462-538, who taught that there can be no knowledge of any kind of first principle. While Plato and Plotinus conflicted with Christian teaching through the disparagement of a possibility of bodily communion with God and direct participation in God by the soul, Pseudo-Dionysius and Edwards directly opposed this by describing those two above things as occurring in the Lord's Supper. Outside the Supper, Edwards also described that bodily manifestations would indicate God's presence. Additionally, Pseudo-Dionysius understood the entire liturgy to be a sensual assimilation into God. Emphasis on unity and communication. Communion and unity within the body and within God are expressed in both the writings of Pseudo-Dionysius and Edwards on the Lord's Supper. Dionysius describes the movement and effect of the Eucharist in the liturgy to cause unity within the body along with the communication of God's nature to the participants. Edward expresses that the sharing of the same nature of Christ by the Spirit unites not only the participant to God, but subsequently everyone else who participates in the same sacrament, the Church. Dionysius' intention of describing the Eucharist as a unifying act is immediately understood by his title of Synaxis. Communion or Synaxis is literally a gathering together of the saints during the celebration of the divine liturgy. This gathering into one is a preeminent theme for the sacramental liturgy, seen in Dennis's preferred usage of it over Eucharist. Thus, the priority of a rite is an ingathering over thanksgiving. This gathering together is a movement whereby Christ is multiplied for the consumption of the believers, and thereby uniformly gathered together the believers back into God. Quote, although it has a unique and simple and enfolded source, is multiplied out of love towards man into the holy variety of the symbols and travels through the whole range of supremely divine description, yet uniformly it is again collected from these into its own proper monody and unifies those who are being recently conducted towards it. Thus, Dionysius explicitly describes that the Eucharist is a means of collecting the divided partakers into one. The expression of unity is also heard in the Great Peace during the Eucharistic liturgy. The peace given during the liturgy expresses that Christian communion cannot occur merely sacramentally without the proper actions between the partakers. Quote, for it is not possible to be collected to the One and to partake of a peaceful union with the One when people are divided amongst themselves. For, if being illumined by the contemplation and knowledge of the One, we would be united to a uniform and divine agreement, we must not permit ourselves to descend to divided less. End quote. Thus, the union that occurs within the Eucharistic liturgy is not merely ontological, but includes an ethical nuance that requires action on the part of its participants. Finally, the act of fractioning the bread and distributing the wine is seen as making a plurality from that which is undivided and totally whole. One bread and cup are broken for the union of many. Quote, for when he has unveiled the veiled and undivided bread and divided it into many and has divided the oneness of the cup to all, he symbolically multiplies and distributes the unity, completing in these an altogether most holy ministration. For the one and simple and hidden of Jesus, the most supremely divine word, by his incarnation amongst us, came forth out of goodness and love towards man, to the compound invisible, and benevolently devised the unifying communion, having united to the utmost our lowliness of the most divine of himself. End quote. This descent of the Eucharist is perceptibly plurality, this descent of the Eucharist to perceptible plurality ultimately results in a conceptual ascent to the simplicity and unity of a higher divine realm. Through this descent into division, the partakers are brought not only to union and communion with one another, but to God himself. Communion with God is a primary effect of a synaxis, whereby God self-communicates himself through the participation of the believer in the sacrament. Quote, the saving mystic rites were exhibited to us, which divinely work the sacred deification of those being initiated. But when it beheld the dearth of divine gifts which came upon us by our heedlessness, it is declared to have called us back to our first condition, by goods restored, and by the complete assumption of what was ours, to have made good the thing's most perfect impartation of his own, and thus to have given to us our participation in God and divine things. End quote. These mystic rites work deification, restoration to our first condition, and a participation in God and divine things for most perfect impartation of what is already Christ. This language of God's self-communication is not limited to the sacraments, but is Dionysius' understanding of the entire work of salvation. Regarding the incarnation and the effects of it, he describes, quote, but having truly participated sinlessly in all things belonging to us, and having been made one with our lowliness in connection with the unconfused and flawless possession of its own properties in full perfection, it bequeathed to us, as henceforth members of the same family, the communion with itself, and proclaimed us partakers of its own beautiful things. End quote. Just as Christ unites our nature to himself in all things except sin, so also by communion with Christ's self are we partakers by grace of the things belonging to him. Furthermore, the same section describes the work of salvation as liberation, quote, from most damnable passions and destructive stains by a perfect deliverance of our being, which is all but prostrate, by showing to us supermundane elevation and an inspired polity in our religious assimilation to itself, as far as is possible, end quote. Thus, salvation for Dionysius is not only expiatory, but a glorification of our human nature. Salvation and its benefits are by virtue of participation in the life of God by grace. Take a drink. The language of union and assimilation into God and its effects of God's self-communication is summarized in Dionysius' last contemplations on the act of eating. Quote, by bringing the veiled gifts to view, by dividing their oneness into many, and by making the recipients partakers of them, by the utmost union of the things distributed with those who receive them, calling the human race through this beneficent love of man into participation with himself and his own good things, provided we are united to his most divine life by our assimilation to it as far as possible, and by this in very truth we shall have been perfected as partakers of God and of divine things." End quote. Thus, it's the actual reception of the elements that are the moment of perfection action. For Edwards, his idea of communion, not the sacrament, frames his understanding of the Lord's Supper. For Edwards' understanding of communion, all societies, when experiencing communion, must have a primary mark of union and common partaking of a specific good. Following that, the secondary mark of communion arises from that primary sharing in the same good, which causes fellowship, friendship, and conversation amongst the partakers of the same good. This vertical and horizontal union is most clearly seen in his sermon on 1 Corinthians 1:9. Quote, "As branches are united by the sap and life, as members by the same blood, so Christians, by being animated all by one spirit, all live as it were one by one life. They are partakers of the same divine nature. The union of Christians with one another is signed and represented in the Lord's Supper as all one family, children of one Father, of one faith, united in interest, partakers of the same privileges, same food, one table, same nature, life, same hope, and inheritance, to the same everlasting inheritance, drinking into one spirit, joy, and comfort." End quote. For Edwards, Christians are united to each other by virtue of sharing and participating in the one life of Christ. The Lord's Supper, which epitomizes this fellowship, causes a sharing in the privileges of Christ that are then shared amongst those united to him. Through the partaking in the body and blood of Christ, Christians share in the same spirit and now partake of not only the same privileges of Christ's salvific work, but share in the same nature, life, hope, joy, and comfort. These privileges of Christ are not things that are merely given, but what Christ has won and has for himself are applied unto those in union with him. Divinization for Edwards, as seen in the Lord's Supper, is where Christ self-communicates himself. This self-communication by grace of Christ's nature is observed in the same sermon on 1 Corinthians 1:9. Quote, "As the members of a body partake of the life of the head, or as the branches of a tree have the same sap of a body and root, now, by believers partaking him, in these following things they partake with him in the same holy temper and disposition. Is God, they are of divine disposition. Therefore, as the Apostle Peter says in 2 Peter 1:4, they are partakers of the divine nature." End quote. Thus, Edwards explicitly identifies his theology of divinization as occurring in the Lord's Supper. The sharing in Christ's spirit, life, and nature are not virtually occurring, but a real participation in the divine life. Thus, Edwards' Lord's Supper between Christians and God involves an ontological communion, but involves a sharing of nature between the divine and between fellow believers in light of how Christ is the head of a union animated by the Spirit, just as branches are united to a tree by the sap and life of the same blood. Considering Edwards' influences of the Cambridge Platonists, including John Smith and Benjamin Wycote, who appealed to 1 Peter 1:4 as a defense for the language of divinization, as a participation in the divine nature, it wouldn't be immature to presume Edwards intends the same teaching in the same above sermon. Furthermore, in a sermon on Canticles 5:1, he describes the spiritual meat and drink that communicates the Holy Spirit. Quote, "Partakers may hope to have our longing souls satisfied in this world by the gracious communications of the Spirit of God." For Edwards, the Holy Spirit is a, quote, "deifying principle that communicates the divine light." End quote. For Edwards, the Spirit intimately unites himself to the believer to become, quote, "as a new supernatural principle of life and action." End quote. The Spirit does this because it is a pure actuality of the infinite consent between the Father and the Son, serving as the union between the Father and the Son. Because goodness, holiness, love, summarizes beauty, is located in the possession of a spirit. Anyone having this same spirit is now in a relationship of beauty with God that causes reorientation of desires and salvific knowledge of God. The spirit being holiness itself, when infused in the nature of the believers, allows by consent greater participation in the life of God. For those that share in the Holy Spirit, they share in the love relation between the Father and the Son. By the Spirit can we know and proclaim God as our Father. By the Spirit are we able to lovingly contemplate Christ as the Son of God. The Spirit, which emanates from the conversation within the Godhead, brings those with the Spirit into the love relation and benefits in the life of God. With this understanding of the Spirit, Edwards' teaching on deification becomes more comprehensible. For Edwards, celebration of the Lord's Supper is principally a work of communion with God. Through this sanctifying grace, believers are imparted the divine nature by partaking of the same Spirit. God self-communicates the believer the benefits of Christ's life and work by sharing the Spirit that emanates from the life within the Godhead and brings the participants into that life, though to a lesser degree. By vertically sharing this same energizing Spirit, believers are thereafter brought into mutual society with each other horizontally. Cumulatively, Dionysius and Edwards share significant continuity in their teachings that the Lord's Supper accomplishes a deification of a believer. This deification is by means of union with Christ and a self-communication of Christ towards the believer. While Edwards' deifying communion may need the understanding of his robust theology of the Spirit to arrive at an unquestionable teaching on divinization, Dionysius' approach is more explicit. Moreover, both theologians organically relate the union between the believer to Christ, causing and perfecting union between fellow believers that partake of the supper. Edwards' corpus of Eucharistic literature, though small, consistently describes a formula of A, common partaking of the good, and B, subsequent mutual theology, and communion from it regarding the creation and creation of a unified body of believers when partaking of the elements. Although Dionysius is not as systematic as Edwards in describing this pattern, he narrates the movement of the liturgy to a move from division, plurality, and multiplication to collection, unity, and uniformity into Christ, God, and divine things. Therefore, in the Lord's Supper, Dionysius and Edwards share a theology of divinization through their understanding of union with Christ, which subsequently causes communion between partakers by virtue of that first union with God. Apophatic Liturgy of Dionysius. Apophaticism for Dionysius is not merely a means of contemplation, but a practice. Dionysius' contemplations or commentary on the liturgy have a progressing theme of desensitization, relinquishing of reason, and imperceptibility as he moves from imitation, baptism, synaxis, or communion, to murin, or consecration of oil. Dionysius frames the three sacraments according to a hierarchy of apophatic imagery. The sacraments are 1. Ordered by their increase by their visibility regarding the inclusiveness of who sees and participates, and 2. Ordered in increasing apophatic imagery regarding a desensitizing and negation of reason. Thus, the movement from baptism to anointing oil is a movement from seen by all to seen by one. Similarly, that which is symbolized becomes increasingly abstract and reducibly sensible. This apophaticism is not arbitrary, but needed for the edification from the sacraments and protection of them. Dionysius describes that the necessity of divine symbols are needed to mediate contemplation of him who is intrinsically incomprehensible and to prevent the danger of approaching and grasping God in his fullness. For the believer, the sacraments are a divine accommodation by which we are being perfected in faith, can gaze upon God without harm as expressed. Quote, "This then, as I think, is clear. Let us next contemplate the divine symbols of a birth of God, and I pray, let no uninitiated person approach the sight, for neither is it without danger to gaze upon the glorious rays of the sun with weak eyes, nor is it without peril to put our hands to things above us. For right was the priesthood of Allah when rejecting Osias, when he put his hand upon sacred things, and Korah, because things sacred above his capacity, and Nadab and Abihu, because they treated things within their province unholily. End quote. The contemplation of the anagogical meaning that the symbols point to both bring us closer to Christ and allow us to grasp God who is ungraspable. While understanding God in his fullness is impossible during our earthly dwelling, the apophatic imagery and its deprivation away from what's positively affirmed allows us to see God more fully beyond the divisions and definitions that we've already mastered, or also called cataphatic theology. The apophatic imagery and symbolism are thus a ladder that assists the believer in their mind and heart's ascent to God. By understanding the symbols and moving towards the less concrete, we prepare ourselves toward the greatest surrender of knowing, where we can then receive God most fully. Apophaticism for Dionysius is not an end for itself in his sacramental scheme. An apophatic posture of surrendering intellect and sense is organically related and necessary for reception and assimilation through the sacraments into the life of God. This posture leaves the believer vulnerable and passive to the unmediated activity of the Trinity. Once we have ascended as far as we could through the apophatic ladder of the sacraments to prepare us for this greatest surrender of knowing, can we then be lifted on high by him who is most hidden and unknowable? This is the premise of Dionysius' liturgical structure in his mystical theology. Quote, "This then is my prayer, but thou, O dear Timothy, by thy persistent commerce with the mystic visions, leave behind doth sensible perceptions and intellectual efforts, and all objects of sense and intelligence, and all things not being and being, and be raised aloft unknowingly to the union as far as attainable with him who is above every essence and knowledge. For by the resistless and absolute ecstasy in all purity, from thyself and all, thou wilt be carried on high to the super essential ray of the divine darkness, when thou hast cast away all, and become free from all." End quote. Accordingly, this freeing from all in the apophatic way is one of ecstasy. We must stand outside of ourselves, enraptured by God, so that by bearing no resistance to God, does he carry us on high to the place where he dwells within, the place where we become free from all. The apophatic practice prepares and is a means towards passively receiving God's active work. Apophaticism is thus wrongly understood if it's merely, quote, as opposed to positive theology, end quote. Following the sufficient mastery of cataphatic theology, the program then takes up the work of apophatic theology. Ultimately, the telos of the apophatic way, following the climb of the apophatic ladder, is to leave our perceptions and affirmations to be moved onto something greater and ineffable. While cataphatic language is one that, quote, searches for God, the apophatic union language is a language full of God. Baptism is the first sacrament of the apophatic ladder. Although baptism is intended to be seen by all, both the church and the enemies of it, the action of baptism itself is materially understood as a movement from visible to invisible and a deprivation of the body in corporeal forms. Quote, "For since death is with us, not an annihilation of being, as ever surmised, but the separating of things united, leading to that which is invisible to us, the soul indeed becoming invisible through deprivation of a body, and the body, though being buried in the earth in consequence of one of its bodily changes, becoming invisible to human ken, appropriately, the whole covering by water would be taken as an image of death and the invisible tomb." End quote. Baptism is apophatic in its direction, moving towards the invisible Christ, quote, leading to that which is invisible to us, end quote. And at the same time is a movement where the visible body moves towards invisibility. Additionally, baptism for Dionysius was an effective movement into Christ. Dionysius saw no difficulty with baptism interpreted as sharing in the death of Christ, uniting us to him who is invisible and unknowable. This apophatic baptism is also pedagogical. Baptism is apophatic in Dionysius' description that this water immersion is a veiling of a body towards invisibility and away from sense perceptions. This deprivation of a body through water submersion symbolically teaches and prepares the deprivation of our body and ourselves once we've reached the apophatic summit. This initiatory deprivation and surrender in baptism additionally mirrors the apophatic surrender that occurs at the accumulation of our deification. The Christian life begins and ends in yielding to the active work of God. Finally, there is an epistemological deprivation in giving up the senses in our baptism that parallels the intellectual surrender that occurs at the culmination of our, quote, being raised to God, end quote, as described in the opening of the mystical theology. The bodily and watery death experienced in our baptism symbolize the loss of senses and self-ability. In that full submersion, the baptized is fully disposed and consented to the person doing the action onto them. Ultimately, our watery burial in baptism is a deprivation of our bodies, knowledge, and serves as a proleptic experience of what occurs once we've reached the summit of the apophatic ladder. The mystery of synaxis, or communion, is the second sacrament and is described as the initiation of initiations. As expounded above, this sacrament brings into union the participants with each other through communion with one another, with the one who is Christ. Regarding its participants, synaxis becomes less visible as the catechumens, possessed, and penitents are dismissed from the sanctuary, while only, quote, those who are deemed worthy of a sight and participation of divine mysteries remain, end quote. Thus, as baptism was a liturgy that involved ubiquitous participation, meaning anyone could watch, the visibility of communion decreases as one ascends the apophatic hierarchy of the sacraments. Although the telos of synaxis as unveiling Christ would appear cataphatic, Eucharist is fundamentally a movement towards the invisible. Dionysius immediately explicitly describes that Christ who is signified is himself a dark mystery and is clothed in symbol for the sake of a sensible contemplation. Quote, but of most divine and holy initiation, uncovering the folds of a dark mysteries, enveloping thee in symbols, be manifest to us in bright glory, and fill our intellectual visions with single and unconcealed light. End quote. Furthermore, the moment of communion is described as a movement revealing the hidden God. Quote, for when he has unveiled the veiled and undivided bread, and divided it into many, and has divided the oneness of a cup to all, he symbolically multiplies and distributes the unity, completing in these an altogether most holy ministration. For the one simple and hidden of Jesus, the most supremely divine word, by his incarnation amongst us, came forth out of goodness and love towards man, to the compound invisible, and benevolently devised the unifying communion, having united to the utmost our lowliness to the most divine of himself. For he delineates in these things under sensible forms our intelligible life and figures, by bringing to view Christ Jesus from the hidden within the divine being. Thus, in the sacrament, the simple and hidden Jesus becomes material and visible for our communion with him. The sacrament may be cataphatic in its revealing, but what it reveals and makes tangible to us is altogether incomprehensible. Regarding the movement towards the apophatic, Christ's condescension into mere elements of bread and wine prepares us to receive Christ in less material and understandable forms. Christ's presence, or being made visible, sounds and appears as foolishness and idiotic, that God would present himself in simple elements of bread and wine. However, Dionysius is aware that some people will, quote, have no ear for these sacred initiations and do not even recognize the image, and in opposition to the oracles reply to their destruction, thy ways I do not wish to know, end quote. Dionysius equates the lack of listening and receiving the symbols as they are as an affront to the sacraments and ultimately a movement away from true knowledge. Thus, Unlike the obstinate, the participant is expected to listen and heed to the symbols which God has chosen to veil himself through. This describes an epistemological deprivation that ends in surrender, such as described in baptism. Although the element of confrontation and Dionysius' explicit description of those that intellectually profane the sacrament by their maintaining of fleshly presuppositions indicate an increasing apophaticism. Ultimately, synaxis is a point of direct confrontation with the reason, over conceding one's understanding to leave ourselves vulnerable to Christ's action of perfecting and assimilating us to himself. The sacrament of urine, or consecrating of oil, sometimes called chrismation, is the last of the sacraments and the most obscure and hidden of the three ordinances. Regarding participants, this sacrament has the least amount of direct partakers in comparison to baptism and communion. In the sacrament of urine, only the hierarch or minister of this liturgy has direct viewing of this divine action. Quote, "What then shall I say further? Is it not these ranks already mentioned, which are not entirely pure, that the present consecrating service excludes without distinction, in the same way as a synaxis, so that it is viewed by the holy alone in figures and is contemplated and ministered by the perfectly holy alone immediately through hierarchical directions?" End quote. The chrismation liturgy is the most alien to us. It consists of a procession with fragrant incense, the taking of the oil and veiling it under a container of 12 sacred rings. Upon the divine altar, a song is then chanted, recounting salvific history, and after finishing the prayer, the murine is then hallowed and saved for the use of future ecclesiastical consecration. The elements of incense and oil upon contemplation are the climax of the apophatic liturgy. The usage of incense underscores the liturgical parallel to Moses' ascending and dwelling in the dark cloud. Incense is not used until this point in the liturgy, where it is processed around the church. This filling of smoke through incense symbolizes entry into the dark cloud or dark gloom described by Dionysius in the Mystical Theology. Thus, it is at this point in the liturgy is the apophatic climax reached by the symbolic entrance into God's dark dwelling. Materially, the apophatic, immaterial, or imperceptible nature of the sacrament of urine is most evident over illumination and synaxis because of its 1, veiling by the 12-folded box, and 2, the nature of fragrance itself. Urine oil is described as being veiled under 12 sacred wings, analogous to the 2 seraphim that stand beside the throne of God or face each other in the imagery of the Ark of the Covenant. Thus, Dionysius intends to describe the imperceptible and enigmatic nature of the murine by the employment of seraphic imagery, indicating the visible presence of God as being in the Holy of Holies. Secondly, the very nature of fragrance is both perceptible but unseen, invisible, and without form. The oil is olfactorily perceived, although not tangible or visible. Furthermore, the perceptibility of the sacrament is according to the distance the receiver is to the source of emanation. The veiled box emanates participation, whereby the proximity to the source defines the assimilation of a partaker in it. Hierarchically, it is the hierarch, then the other presiding ministers, and lastly, the rest of the congregation that can be assimilated into this divine indwelling according to rank. The apophatic nature of fragrance maintains a paradoxical tension, as Neoplatonists enjoy, between the sensible stimulus of dwelling within us while not being fully tangible. This highlights that while the unknown God is breathed into us, full consummation into God is not yet achieved. Fragrance anticipates a fuller dwelling of God in us in our glorification. Although this is soteriologically true in Dionysius' eschatology, Dionysius does not attribute the entire liturgy as foreshadowing an eschatological event. Murin first teaches the ascending pilgrim to leave behind what is tangible, put themselves in a position for the divine energy to assimilate us, and passively receive God's emanating work towards us. The posture that we must be in to be exercised and carried by God is preceded by the practice that one's proximity to the source or the summit of the apathetic must be reached. Furthermore, once brought near to the source of divine essence, all we can do is allow it to penetrate us. Concerning this apophatic passivity, while baptism and synaxis involve a level of participation and consent in allowing one to be submerged and the actual act of consuming the elements, the indwelling and perception of incense occurs without the action or will of its believer. So also does this final apophatic posture and surrender to God involve nothing of our own doing, except our reception of his deifying act. As stated above, for Dionysius, apophatic theology is not a mere cognitive inquiry, but a liturgical exercise. The practice of apophaticism and the passivity towards God entailed is intended to be understood when it's coupled with its Neoplatonic theurgy. Sacraments and the divine liturgy are a theurgy, meaning a work of God, not as an objective genitive indicating a work addressed to God, but as a subjective genitive, meaning God's own work done unto us. Moreover, Dionysius describes the posture of a believer at the top of the apophatic summit with future efficacy and the passive verb tense in the phrases be raised and will be carried in his introduction in the mystical theology. Dionysius orders the structure of the sacraments by templating the ascent of Moses, the same section of a mystical theology. Moses is first purified, or baptized. After he participates in a meal with the priest's elders, he ascends alone towards the summit, paralleling the movement of a hierarch in synaxis. Then finally, in reaching the summit, Moses enters into the dark cloud and experientially communes with the invisible God, as in Murin. Thus, the sacraments are an apophatic exercise that prepare the pilgrim for God's theurgic assimilation into himself, where at the summit, the worshipper is called to, quote, renounce all the mind may conceived, wrapped entirely in the intangible intangible, and belong completely to him who is beyond everything, end quote. Cataphaticism in Edwards. While there appears to be a significant degree of continuity regarding divinization and self-communication in the sacraments between the two theologians, apophaticism is not found within Edwards' understanding of baptism or Lord's Supper. Unlike Dionysius, who described the sacraments as a veil and symbol of divine things, Edwards' treatment of the Lord's Supper is entirely cataphatic. Edwards is strongly affirmative in his teaching of the Lord's Supper as a real presentation of the First Supper. The Supper is not a Zwinglian representation or symbol, but a liturgical reproduction, like that of theatrical plays, of the very First Supper and Passion of Christ. Furthermore, he integrates this with his uncommon emphasis on the objective real presence of Christ. While Dionysius describes the sacraments through apophatic imagery to approximate nebulous celestial typologies, Edwards would cathartically describe the sacraments directly manifest what they represent. Representation for Edwards has a sense of reenacting, quote, almost everything that belongs to the First Communion, end quote. A further understanding of his use of representation can be found from Ephraim Chambers' Cyclopedia, a resource Edwards extrapolated from in several of his writings and even quoted at length in his Religious Affection. Chambers' definition of representation is given as in the following, quote, representation in the drama, the exhibition or action of a theatrical piece, including the scenes, machines, the recitation, and etc. See scene, machine, recitation, and etc. Sir Richard Steele's principle is that the design of a play is not to be read, but represented, so that 'tis on the stage not in the press to be judged of, and the pit, not the public, are the judges. Feeder Edwards' teaching of a Lord's Supper as Edwards' teaching of a Lord's Supper as a representation is truly a reenactment and representation. While not failing to the Zwinglian sense of memorial, the supper reenacts not by words read, but represented, as Danaher describes. End quote. It incorporated the sense of the Lord's Supper as a visible word, for the elements, as scenes and machines, serve the purposes of providing fallen humanity with visible signs of an invisible grace. These different senses of representation as memorial, spiritual feast, and visible word culminated in the occasion where Christ and his benefits were represented to the saints in the divine drama of salvation. End quote. If we are to describe Edwards' conception of a re-presentation, extrapolating from theatrical language, the Lord's Supper is, quote, a passion play where it reaches its climax when the main character, Jesus Christ, takes the stage, end quote. This understanding of reenacting and participating in the first events further allows Edwards to articulate a strong emphasis of Christ's real presence. In a sermon on 1 Corinthians 11:29, Edwards describes that when the minister speaks at a table, it's as if Christ stands there, quote, offering us the elements to us and therein offering us his benefits, end quote. The humanity of Christ is heard in corporeal language of touch and taste besides our seeing, and that we handle Christ as Thomas did and put our fingers into the prints of the nails and our hands in his side, end quote. And Christ presents himself not only, quote, present among us, but as being slain amongst us, end quote. At this banquet, we are invited to his home to sit at his table and converse with him. Within Edwards' theatrical understanding of the supper, congregants are placed in the events of a first supper and Christ's passion as if they are there during the first event in history. Partakers do not redo the act, but participate in the event's first instance. Thus, Edwards describes that it is Christ at the table and his pierced side they partake from. In the supper, believers are at the events symbolized. Concludingly, Edwards' teaching on representation and real presence seemingly emphasized the direct realness the supper has in relationship to the object they signify. There are no mystical symbols, transcendent analogies, or mediated imagery as in Dionysius. For Edward, it could possibly be said that the Lord's Supper uncomplicatedly is what it represents. The event symbolized by the minister is a direct participation in the first events as if the congregation is there and is thus entirely cataphatic. This is the last section. Why the difference between Edwards and Dionysius on apophaticism? Thus, the concluding question becomes, what explains the difference between Edwards and Dionysius on the inclusion of apophaticism in the sacraments? Two possible responses are, 1. Edwards' eschatological archetype justified a cataphatic theology of the sacraments, while Dionysius, while having a celestial typology for the sacraments, did not locate the sacraments as being an eschatological foreshadowing in the culmination of salvific history. 2. Edwards' apophaticism were the boundaries of conceiving God and a no-entry sign rather than a means to approach God, while for Dionysius, apophaticism was a means to proceed towards him. While Dionysius' sacraments were a type of scaffold in the approach to God and were analogic enigmas that pointed to transcendent realities that were ungraspable and hidden, Edwards' cataphatic eschatological archetype led him to believe the sacraments were a direct participation, although to a lesser degree, of the eschatological marriage supper of a lamb at the end of redemptive history. Dionysius and Edwards' first discontinuity are on their usage of a redemptive historical eschatology. For Edwards, what the saints did on earth would only continue to its fullest degree in the kingdom. In the supper we share at church, we have, quote, the foretaste of that eternal feast with Christ in glory, end quote. The bread and wine believers enjoyed were, quote, pledge of a future glorious communion and partaking with Christ when they shall drink new wine with him in his kingdom, end quote. The spiritual feast of the saints in this world was a forthcoming of the eternal feast in heaven. While Dionysius does not make any eschatological analysis or statements of the synaxis, Edwards' eschatological understanding of the supper was elemental to his teaching. Thus, as Neoplatonists, both theologians held to a type and transcendent anti-type pattern. As a Neoplatonist, Dionysius believed the sacraments were types and shadows of a transcendent celestial forms. Although maintaining apophatic convictions, Dionysius describes the fulfillment nebulously, believing that to preserve the highest reverence for divine things. Edwards cataphatically describes the sacrament because of its direct participation in the first event and its continuity to its fullest degree in the eschatological wedding feast. The difference between Dionysius and Edwards is seen in how we describe the anti-type fulfillment for the sacraments. Dionysius's apophaticism is related to maintaining an indefinite transcendent celestial archetype, while Edwards' cataphaticism is concluded from his continuity between the present sacrament to its eschatological fulfillment at the end of redemptive history. Dionysius's apophaticism necessitates an inability to define the fulfillment and thus maintains a discontinuity between the pilgrimage and the fulfillment, or the archetype and archetype. While Edwards' eschatological event of the wedding feast justified that the pilgrimage of the supper was the same or direct participation in the fulfillment of both to a lesser degree. Secondly, Edwards' species of an apophatic account of divine simplicity was classical in that it served as a, quote, dogmatic function of a boundary marker beyond which the theologian may not stray. Edwards' simplicity essentially describes that God is without composition, but it does not specify exactly how he is without composition, end quote. Edwards' usage of apophaticism was limited to his teaching on divine simplicity and did not go beyond that. Edwards, as well as the Reformed Orthodox, did not use apophatic divine simplicity to, quote, to paint a portrait of God. Its aim was to put up no entry signs in front of certain roads into which we might turn when trying to think about God, end quote. This is consistent with the Reformed Scholastics on divine simplicity. For Edwards, apophatic theology was not the path of ascent towards approaching God, but delimited what and where was correct to travel. However, Dionysius treats the apophatic holy enigmas and a variety of symbols as a means of entry to God, both sacramentally and conceptually. Before describing an apophatic practice of liturgy, Dionysius already establishes the apophatic way as a legitimate approach to God in the divine names and mystical theology, precipitating its later manifestation into the observations and practices described in the ecclesiastical hierarchy. Overall, Dionysius and Edwards share a new Platonic philosophy, which gave them shared grounds for God's self-communication, participation, archetype-ectype distinctions, and types of divine simplicity. Although, as Neoplatonists, their understanding of the sacraments differed from their articulation of the archetype fulfillment. Edwards gives a cataphatic treatment because of the continuity between the present supper and the wedding feast of the Lamb at the eschaton of redemptive history. Although, instead of an eschatological foreshadowing, Dionysius' conviction to apophaticism led him to describe a nebulous celestial archetype. Finally, their conclusions on the usage of apophatic theology cause another point of discontinuity. For Dionysius, apophaticism was a legitimate means of approaching God, conceptually, which entailed practice form of that theology. Whereas, Edwards maintained a classical and minimalist apophaticism in his theology of divine simplicity that intended to serve as a boundary for Christian thought, and never as an intended means.